and welcome to Aloha Authentic. I'm your host, Kamaka Pili. On today's show, we're speaking with Kanilea Ukulele about the ukulele. Interesting fact, as much as the ukulele is a Hawaiian instrument and a symbol of Hawaiian music, its inspiration is from Portugal. Did you know? Now you do. He's the owner of Kanilea Ukulele. Please welcome to the show, Joe Souza. Thank you very much, Ako. I am so excited for this because we're speaking about ukulele, as we all are familiar with that instrument. But of course, on our show, we have our protocol here on Aloha Authentic. Our umeke, our bowl of poi, is open on the table because Tutu used to always say, when the bowl of poi is open on the dinner table, there's no negativity spoken. Everything is positive and happy stories, and that's what we're going to be talking about with the ukulele. Because as we heard on the top of the show, that it may be a Hawaiian instrument, but it's not necessarily from Hawaii. So before we get into that, Uncle Joe, tell us a little bit about Kanilea Ukulele and your foundation to ukulele.
Well, you know, music has always been such an important part of my life, ukulele especially. Growing up, some of the fondest memories is paina, kanika pila, everybody singing, everybody playing. And even though I wasn't necessarily playing, I was more just involved. And in the fourth grade, of course, getting introduced to the ukulele, just so happened my fourth grade teacher happened to be my mom's twin sister.
So there's no way out of it.
Yeah, you sit in here in the front of the class and you're gonna learn ukulele. But she planted a seed, which is a love for this instrument. And she also taught when you play, you sing. And things that I see now that are really foundational in building ukulele as a player. So looking at how sound was created, you know, and just kind of feeding this young inquisitive mind on what the ukulele does and how it holds a note and everything that is involved with ukulele.
It's interesting you say play and sing, mm-hmm. because I tried a couple times of just trying to play. It doesn't really work. I don't know how to play ukulele, but then you add singing. That's like two sides of your mind at the same time. So learning both at the same time, I can only imagine is a little easier than learning how to play.
Yeah. And it made sense now, especially if I had to try and learn how to play and sing. I mean, it's like tapping your head, scratching your belly, or whatever. You know?
Good luck, guys. Yeah. Okay, but I mean, let's learn a little bit about the ukulele. It's not it's a Hawaiian instrument, but not necessarily from Hawaii, but Portugal.
Yes.
So what is the story of the ukulele?
So really the origins was part of our Portuguese immigrants who came to Hawaii, who brought so many parts of Portugal, you know, beyond malasadas and Portuguese sausage
or
and
vinodos,
all that kind of stuff. They also brought their musical instrument. In this case, the breguinha or the mechete de Braga was this small guitar, to say, that just totally intrigued the Hawaiians. And here was an opportunity to kind of translate a lot of what hula and mele was onto a string instrument in this case, to be able to hold a chord or to hold a note. And even, you know, that style of, you know, accompanying you as a vocalist, and then as the mele kind of translated from ukulele, and really the ukulele kind of being now a key component in pretty much every Hawaiian trio or quartet. You know, the ukulele is still that percussion kind of foundation instrument for Hawaiian music.
I always look at the ukulele something like spamusubi or saimin, a result of other cultures, and Hawaii being a melting pot of cultures, it really comes from that. So I think that's a beautiful thing.
Right.
But then what is the difference then between a ukulele and the mechete? Is that what it's called?
Yeah. So the mechete, really the tuning is different. It's more like tuned like a violin or a mandolin, or what's called tuned in fifths. Whereas the ukulele is kind of more a hybrid between guitar, you know, and that tuning, but brought up five steps, to say. So really, in its own unique way, the ukulele has its own tuning in comparison to really any other instrument. And that's what really set it apart as far as the tone and the sound. When we look at, say, the Royal Hawaiian Band, and having all of these multiple instruments where the ukulele kind of found its lane in there too, as its own unique sound, even on a big band kind of, you know, ground, to say.
You were sharing a little bit prior to our filming that you actually took a trip to Portugal and kind of followed the steps of these immigrants. Is that correct to say? What is that story?
You know, that was an amazing journey, going back and really tracing the roots to the ukulele. And it was really in celebration of the 140th anniversary of the first ship that sailed from Madeira, bringing, you know, the ancestor to the ukulele, which is the machete or the braguena, that ultimately just intrigued the Hawaiians, right? But one of the interesting things that when we got there was our host got us checked in and said, hey, you know, just go relax, I'll be back in the morning. So when she came back, she said, hey, did you get a chance to see the church here in Santa Maria, which is where we were staying, Santa Maria Hotel? And we said, no. She goes, you have to go see the church because that's where your grandmother was baptized. It's like, what? Crazy chicken skin moment, right? So we all go, our boys and as a ohana, we go and we traced really the tracks of where my grandmother was baptized. And you know, the other interesting thing that we really seen while we were there that like totally touched our heart was the fact that this island home that they live on in Madeira, literally in the middle of the Pacific, and how important sustainability was.
You know, and speaking of sustainability, I hear that with every ukulele kanile'a sells, you contribute back to our island by planting a kōtri.
Absolutely.
That is awesome. You know what? Stick around, because coming up after the break, we're going to dive deeper into that and their sustainability aspect of their business. We're going to heli on to Hawaii Island to their ranch where this is all done. That's coming up right here on Aloha Authentic. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. We have picked up our set and moved here to the slopes of Mauna Loa. This is known as the ranch to Kanile'a Ukulele. And thank you very much, Uncle Joe, for having us. This is a beautiful space. I wish you could see it, the extent of it. Mm-hmm. But what's even more beautiful is the fact that you contribute back to our aina by planting a tree for every ukulele that you sell. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about that.
You know, that really started from a simple goal, to plant a koa tree for every ukulele we build. And as we stepped into, and today, as we're like engaged in the restoration of our native forests, we've planted over 35,000 trees. And really, we learned that it's the biodiversity that's so important to our native Hawaiian forests. Koa is super important, but so is mamaki, mamane, iliahi, and all of these native species that are part of a biodiverse forest.
That's really interesting, especially mentioning iliahi, because if you haven't already seen it, in our last season, we spoke with Uncle Wade Lee at Ahaloa Aina and restoring the ecosystem through iliahi and really seeing the result of it, which for him, he actually has a rain meter that shows the increase of rain over the years because of his work. Mm. Have you seen, or what do you see to know that what you're doing is having a benefit or a positive impact?
I think the biggest component that we see, besides the canopy and the native birds and all of these native species returning, is the increase in our water cycle and how this natural water cycle has been in place for eons. And for areas that were cut, we have now restored, which in turn is bringing that water cycle back and really benefiting everyone Makai from where we're doing our work.
I heard, is this true? So koa trees are very unique if you pay attention to the leaves, where I guess typically leaves face up towards the sun, but koa trees are actually facing to the side. And I was told it's because when the wind blows, it pushes the moisture into the leaf and it acts somewhat of like a sponge, pulling the moisture down into the tree. Is that true?
That is absolutely true. And the way that the koa leaf actually works, of course, photosynthesis takes place as a traditional leaf, but it's really like an extension of their roots, where the uhiwai, or this beautiful cloak of water, comes in every day, and the koa sits there and drinks through its leaves and really nourishes itself. And then whatever is excess, because of the way that the leaves are shaped, that excess water drips down, which in turn helps to feed the understory. And really under each koa tree, we'll see the understory flourishing, which is a sign of a healthy forest.
That's beautiful. going back to ukulele, okay, so kōtri, is it, I mean, we look at many ukulele, kanilea in particular as well, made out of core wood. Mm-hmm. Is core wood what was traditionally used to make ukulele?
It is today, and I would say everyone associates a Hawaiian-made ukulele with core. But in reality, there are other tone woods, other hardwoods that create tone from Hawaii also. For example, we have our maulino, which is a truly native ukulele. And all of the wood that we use to build that instrument is all endemic wood. Mm. Koa, ohialehua, iliahi for the bracing, and all of the different components are really made from native Hawaiian hardwoods, which has a unique tone. It's different, to say, than an alkoa ukulele.
Question. Speaking of tone, as I'm, my 101 Hawaiian can understand, kanilea, mm-hmm. in terms of your name, means like a joyful sound. Mm-hmm. But what is the origins to that name?
It's actually our family name. So the whole name is kanilea ukaunaheleopa'i'i, which literally translates to the joyful sound from the deep forest.
That's beautiful.
Where people go as a source. And it really fits perfectly to what we're doing, in the sense, kanilea, joyful sound, and how we bring joy to people's lives through ukulele. Whether you're just listening, or if you're playing, and more importantly, if you're playing and singing, the type of joy that the ukulele can bring to your life is kanilea.
And you see that in all kind of pa'ina, especially in the backyard with the mm-hmm. hibachi and some beers popped. Is all ukulele the same? I mean, just within kanilea, you guys have many different styles.
I would say that not all ukuleles are the same. And the reason why is different tones, different woods that are used, but even different features. For example, for kanilea ukulele, we have what we call true innovations. We have our true bracing, our true relief, our true setup. All of these components that are important to a good sounding ukulele, and beyond that, a great sounding ukulele. So these true innovations really set us apart as far as kanilea ukulele.
What does the word ukulele even mean?
Literally, ukulele is uku, or head lice. Lele is to jump, so jumping flea. But I remember when Queen Liliuokalani was asked, what does ukulele mean, her translation of ukulele? And her answer was, the gift to the world. Mm. And the ukulele truly is Hawaii's gift to the world.
That's beautiful. I did hear someone also explain that jumping flea also refers to, like, I guess the way that it's picked and that your fingers are kind of like moving all over the place. Is that also true?
That is, you know, there are kind of two interpretations. Yeah. One is the advanced player's fingers move quickly across the fingerboard, which resembled jumping fleas. The other was these Portuguese immigrants who introduced the ukulele were so happy, they jumped up and down, strumming their breguenha, looking like jumping fleas. Now, of course, being half Portuguese, I love the first rendition of the advanced player's fingers.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Uncle Joe. That is beautiful. Coming up after the break, we're going to head down to the kanilea showroom, grab your ukulele, because we're actually going to learn how to play the ukulele. That's coming up next on Aloha Authentic. What decade do you think this instrument was invented in? Was it A, 1870s, B, 1900s, C, 1920s, or D, 1950s? The answer when we return. What decade do you think this instrument was invented in? The answer is C, 1920s. The tremoloa is a type of string instrument that became popular in the early 20th century. Belonging to the fretless zither family, the tremoloa was born out of the international craze for Hawaiian music and was made to replicate the sound of the Hawaiian steel guitar. Originally priced at $40, the introductory songs for the instrument were a mix of Hawaiian and American hit songs, which speaks to the range of popular music in the 1920s and 30s. These titles include The Aloha Waltz, On the Beach at Waikiki, and Home on the Range. Did you know? Now you do. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. We are here back on Oahu in Kaneohe at Windward Mall inside the Kanilea shop. So thank you very much, Uncle Joe, again for everything you've shared and allowing us to be here. I think it's great because now we can visually see the difference between the different styles of ukulele. What are the different styles?
Well, really, it's the size first. So the soprano being the smallest of the family and really the closest cousin to the Braguinha and the Machete Braga. When we look at the concert, which is a little bigger, for years the concert was the size. That was the big ukulele to say. Till finally the tenor made its way. And honestly, the tenor has kind of carved its way as becoming the modern day standard. Everybody plays a tenor. And then of course the baritone, which is the biggest of the family. But a lot of people will say the baritone is just like a guitar, which it is, tuned like a guitar. So a lot of guitar players are kind of attracted to the baritone. And it has its own unique tuning and its own unique sound also. But really the tenor today is the modern day standard.
Okay, I get this question a lot. Kamaka, do you know how to play ukulele? Here, play a music, play a song. Mm-hmm. And I tell them, no, I don't. Just because my name is Kamaka doesn't mean I know how to play ukulele. But can I change that by you teaching me how to play something?
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Yeah, so okay. We'll take a look here. I got a tenor and actually you grab the concert, which is a beautiful size ukulele. That's what I played for years. And really that's a more traditional concert, okay, as far as size and style, although we did an inlay of the Hawaiian Islands, our pai aina, mm-hmm, out of Paua, and the different inlays from the New Zealand abalone. But as far as look and sound, generally, it's a very traditional concert ukulele. Whereas this is a tenor, but really kind of a non-conventional tenor when we look at the sound hole and where the placement of the sound hole is. It's kind of on the side, which in turn helped us to open up the soundboard. And new bracing, more sound, warmer tones, and even a side sound port, which then delivers sound to you as a player, kind of like a monitor, you know, as an entertainer. Okay. So the combination is really to accompany you as the ukulele is a great accompanying instrument. Now, as far as playing goes, I would say, you know.
It's a little bit more challenging, at least for me.
You ready?
So the first thing, I've always was curious, when you're playing ukulele and you strum it, I know some people strum down, some people strum up. What is the proper way to strum an ukulele?
I think it really depends on your style and what you're playing, because there are certain strums where, you know, like today we're gonna play a down, down, up, up, down strum.
Okay.
And there's also, you know, the more traditional Hawaiian strums are the double strum, which really is just an extension of the ipu heke. And that percussion sound that the ipu provides now being translated onto the ukulele. So you may start the strum on an up strum, kind of like on a half beat.
Okay, I never thought of it like that.
Yeah, but you know, that's where the ukulele, again, is such a Hawaiian instrument because it was an important component in hula.
Okay, so what can I tell people? Yeah, I know how to play, this song. What song can you teach me?
Yeah, I was thinking, what would be the perfect song, easy to learn? So I thought maybe island style.
Okay.
And I'll go teach you like how my mom taught me, the chords and everything. So
by the way, if you have an ukulele, now is the time to grab it and learn along with me.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're gonna play in the key of C. What you're gonna do is get your ring finger on the 3rd fret, 1st string.
Okay.
And then just go ahead and strum your ukulele. So that's the key of C.
So do you strum with your fingertips or your fingernail?
I use my fingernail. Yeah, because the sound is cleaner.
Okay.
Yeah. And then you're gonna now learn the hardest chord in the whole ukulele repertoire, which is pointer finger, 1st string, 1st fret.
I can do that.
That's C7.
Okay.
And then we're gonna go to F. So you're gonna move that pointer finger up and just play the 2nd string, 1st fret. And that's how my mom used to play the F. Okay. That was her style of F. And then from there, you'll learn a G7. And the way that my mom taught me is you leave that pointer finger there, and now you bring your middle finger and go onto the 3rd string, 2nd fret, right there. So that's G7.
When you say your mom played it like this, is that the only, I mean, did she do a different variation than everybody else does?
In a way, yes. Because there are some who would play a more conventional G7 or conventional F, but my mom always played what I thought was an easier version of the chord. But now, as I understand music more, it's actually really a lot more complex. We're like fancy chords, but just in an easy way to hold them.
See, because one of the challenges that I deal with, and I don't know if everybody else does too, but my fingers don't move in certain ways where you have to put all these other kind of things together. So if there's just a 1-2 chorded thing, then I could do that.
That's right.
The cheat chords. Yeah.
But you know, with these four chords, oh, it opens up our whole repertoire. We can play hi'ilawe, we can play akaimele, okay, just with the simple C, C7, F, and G7.
Okay.
Ready?
I'm ready.
Shoot, we go. Okay. Okay. You can get them already. C7.
No bachi yet.
On the island, we do it island style. From the mountain to the ocean, from the windward to the leeward side. On the island, we do it island style. From the mountain to the ocean, from the windward to the leeward side.
This jumping part, I want to get to the point where I'm going to do this, you know, and then be like Kavika Trask, who does this.
All right.
Thank you very much. That was so cool. Stay tuned. Aloha Authentic. We'll be right back.
Awesome.
Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. I hope you enjoyed your conversation because, Uncle, I know I sure did. A little makana from us to you.
Mahalo nui.
Thank you for your time. Mm-hmm. You know, I know there's a lot more that you offer than what we were able to cover. What else do you guys offer?
We have the Ukulele Underground, which is this wonderful online platform to learn and really master the ukulele. We also have the Ukulele Club of Hawaii right at Center Court Woodward Mall every first Tuesday of the month. And you can always go to our website, sign up for that email blast, and stay up to date with what everything Kanile'a is doing in the community.
For this episode's featured artist, we're featuring Puna Noni Naturals. As certified vegan, GMO-free, and cruelty-free, Puna Noni Naturals is a locally owned company offering clean, healthy, and earth-friendly body care products that are safe for you and your family. Be sure to visit their website and social media handles to find out more.
Thank you very much, Uncle. I really enjoyed this. And if you aren't already doing so, be sure to follow us on our social media. Until next time, aloha, ahui ho.
Aloha no.